Bonjour, bienvenue au FIFDH, 19e édition Genève. Aujourd'hui, nous avons la chance de recevoir un pianiste, compositeur parmi les plus déterminants de la musique dite post-minimaliste ou bien néoclassique, Max Richter. Max Richter, auteur d'une œuvre artistique dense, passionnante, toujours bouleversante, composée pour des orchestres symphoniques, pour le théâtre, pour le ballet, pour le cinéma ou bien la télévision. Max Richter qui publie en 2020 Voices, 9e album studio d'une beauté déchirante, inspiré de la Déclaration des droits humains et que mit en image son associée créative, Yulia Mahr, cinéaste et productrice. Yulia Mahr, par ailleurs, membre du jury international du FIFDH 2021. Comment et pourquoi mettre la Déclaration des droits humains en musique? Que peut la musique pour les droits humains et pour qu'ils avancent dans le sens de la justice? Aussi, que nous apprend la crise du Covid-19 sur l'importance fondamentale que tient la musique, la culture et la beauté dans nos vies et dans nos sociétés. De tout cela, on parle avec Max Richter et Yulia Mahr entre Londres et Genève. Une rencontre animée par Davide Rodogno, professeur d'histoire internationale au Graduate Institute, durant laquelle nous diffuserons aussi des vidéos musicales exclusives tirées des séances d'enregistrement de l'album Voices et de concert donné par Max Richter. Pour introduction à cette rencontre exceptionnelle, je laisse la parole à Madame Michelle Bachelet, haut-commissaire des Nations Unies aux droits de l'homme.
Greetings to all of you. It is a great pleasure to be able to take part in this festival. These events, which have become so important to the city of Geneva that we love, are very helpful in maintaining an emphasis on the human stories of human rights. Yes, human rights are about laws, policies, and regulations. Yes, they're about governments and international bodies, but above all, they're about people. About young people of every gender, color, and ethnicity yearning for justice, women warriors for equality who are arbitrarily jailed, children forced into exploitation, stories that are as varied and as important as all the human beings in our world. Everyone of the 30 articles of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights stands for the destiny, the pain, the joy, and generosity of millions of individuals. And at this festival, it is their stories which are shared. But this event today is a little different. It is about music. An orchestra of voices that has been put together by the visionary Max Richter and Yulia Mahr to contemplate and celebrate the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It weaves people's voices and messages in their mother tongues into a tapestry of sound that is also like a river, a single flowing creation made up of many small and vital things. This is a message of community and care, a message of endurance. It speaks to us of eternal and universal values, principles which are essential to the existence of humanity and the purpose of our lives. All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. It is both a deep and simple truth and a complex and endless struggle for justice. It is a message that encompasses all the stories this festival has ever featured. And at its core, it presents solutions to many, perhaps all, the economic, social, and policy dilemmas of our world. The careful cadence of this performance, its subtle use of many languages, and its universal messages call us to reflect deeply about the nature of our values and the meaning of what we do. All around us, things are changing very rapidly. The pandemic of COVID-19 has upended our lives, our workplaces, our families, our loved ones, our schools. And it has brought home a number of essential lessons. We can see how the pandemic raced through the fault lines in society that had been created and maintained by generations of harsh discrimination and unprincipled exploitation. We can see how it expanded those fractures and used them as drivers to propel its contagion. We can see how the failure to uphold the fundamental rights to social protection, to health care, rights that are enumerated clearly in the Universal Declaration, has increased the pandemic spread and impact. COVID-19, like all crises, speaks to the universality of human rights because it shows us how violations of human rights harm everyone, and shows us how upholding human rights protects everyone. Nobody could claim to see a positive side to this devastating pandemic, which has caused so much death and poverty. But I hope very deeply that we will gather the strength to apply its lessons as we begin to rebuild systems and policies that are better than before. Better because they are more fair, because they are more inclusive, because they embrace and advance people's right to speak out, to shape public decisions, to access essential resources and services, and to share the benefits of development. We need, all of us, to stand up for human rights, perhaps now more than ever before. Every woman, man, and child is born free and equal, and should remain so. And it's long past time to build the structures that will deliver those rights to everyone. Music, like art, and like human rights, speaks to all of us. United in this music, drinking in the power of these words, I hope you will have a memorable evening. Thank you very much.
Quelquefois prendre la place de la politique quand la politique pour des raisons économiques est bloquée.
It's important to be able to write about violence with the same intimacy with which I write about love.
We created the kind of community that allowed us to give expression to our dignity.
Black lives matter.
African young people.
Actually, I'm not a hero.
Max, Yulia, it's a great pleasure to have both of you with us tonight. And we're here tonight to discuss precisely about voices. I have questions for both of you. I would like to start with a question for Max. With voices, you attempted something quite unique and unprecedented. What is the purpose of blending music to human voices? And why the Universal Declaration for Human Rights?
Well, the Universal Declaration is a kind of, it's a sort of roadmap, isn't it? A roadmap for a better world, an incredibly inspiring text. And I'm a musician, so when I hear an inspiring text, I want to have a conversation with that creatively by writing a piece of music. Composers, human beings, have always joined texts and music. You know, meaningful texts inspire music. And for me, and for us, I think we felt that to make a creative work, a musical response to this piece would be a nice way to kind of shine a light on it in a different way and to provide a creative or musical space for people to encounter that text, encounter those words, and to spend time reflecting on them.
So were you seeking for the musicality in the text, or the other way around? Were you seeking for the textuality of music, and why in the end speaking the Human Rights Declaration rather than singing it?
Yeah, I mean, I guess for me, it's all about intelligibility. You know, I see the piece really as being a way for people to spend time with these words. And of course, sung words can be, you know, less easy to understand. But at the same time, the human voice, even when speaking, is musical. So particularly with the languages that, you know, I don't understand, you know, I was responding to those things really as musical sound objects.
Yulia, I have a question for you. You've been involved with this project since its very inception. And as we know, you work with images and videos and movies. I was wondering whether there was an event or a set of events that triggered voices and your understanding of the project.
Well, I think any of our projects that are any good come from kind of multiple origin stories, if you like. There's never one thing that triggers them. There's a whole pile of things that triggers them. And in this case, voices comes from my own backstory. I came to the UK age 7 or 8, and my mother and I had fled from Hungary. It wasn't only political, it was to flee a horrible father. But it was a very relevant topic to me, the human rights and what happened to me and trying to get my stamp here to stay and all those things. And we've talked a lot about it since we met 30 years ago. That's been our topic of conversation about the rights of citizens. I was doing plays about the mothers that disappeared when we met, so it's been a big conversation. And then more recently, really, it was post the Twin Towers, unfortunately, coming down, and the post-truth politics and what's been happening to the world that really triggered us to start thinking about putting a project together.
I see. There is something that seems to be a continuity in both your work. You took position a number of times in the past. You reacted to the conflict in Kosovo in 1999. You reacted to the wars in Iraq a number of times. You reacted to terrorist attacks in London in 2005. And so there is something that has to do with really an international dimension, and something else that has to do with a more domestic reality. So do you see these events as having an impact and shaping up your artistic work?
I think, artists are human beings first. We live in the world and things happen in the world. And if you're a creative person, your creative work will naturally be a response to that in some way, either explicitly or maybe implicitly. For me, it's a really instinctive thing. I think, we're drawn to things which we feel are important and we want to talk about. And if, as a composer, my kind of first language, if you like, is music. So I respond to that musically, and Yulia responds to that by, her visual work. So I think this is quite natural, and I think many artists feel this way.
Right. I suggest something. I will invite our public to listen to and watch to Mercy, which was realized by you, Yulia, and was recorded at Air Studio not long ago. And this is the official video.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
That was really a very moving video. Thank you very much, Yulia and Max, for sharing it with us. I would like to move on and to ask a question or a set of questions that will connect voices with the current civil rights struggle. But before doing that, and because of the emotional dimension of the movie itself, I had a specific question for Yulia. You were the one who, in the end, translated voices into images through the video. The humanity we see in it is very simple. It's very sober, but at the same time, there is a sense of loneliness, the kind of loneliness that we might experience when we watch Edward Hopper paintings. Would you agree with me, or is this just an individual reaction?
I think my work is a little melancholic. I think probably Max's work is a little melancholic too. I think melancholy is kind of a reasonable answer to the problems of today, isn't it? So yes, I would agree that there is a kind of loneliness there.
Okay, Max, you said at some point that the Universal Declaration is about the future, that it is about a world that we have not yet created. And to me, this sounds as if the Universal Declaration was a mirage. It seems to be very close to us, but in fact, we cannot even touch it. Would you agree with that?
Well, yes. I mean, in a sense, it's an ideal. It's a story about a kind of a perfect, better world, maybe. But it is a human creation. You know, it's a human creation which comes out of a very dark time. And nonetheless, you know, people sat down, they talked to one another, they worked this thing out, and it was agreed. So I think in its very existence, it demonstrates potential.
Yeah.
Potential for things to get better. And I think a thing like that is a very inspiring thing to have in the world.
Yeah, I was thinking about the Declaration being, you know, sometimes very heavily criticized because precisely it silenced the voices of so many people, and specifically colonial populations that were still pretty much oppressed at the time the Declaration was signed up. And in your answer, you seem to indicate that you seem to be very interested in is its potential.
Yeah, I think so. You know, we're human creatures, which means we are imperfect. Nonetheless, it points kind of in the right direction, doesn't it? I think the thing that struck me working with the text, and Yulia and I talked about this at the time, is that, you know, when you read it in a way, it has a sort of feeling of obviousness and kind of naturalness. There are many things in it which, you know, a tiny children would just instinctively agree with. And I think there's something very very striking about that.
How do you, both of you, in your respective work, triangulate melancholia with hope and the videos, the images, and the music?
That's a very interesting question.
How do you triangulate melancholia and hope? I think it is possible to feel both overwhelmed by the world and slightly sad at it and hopeful of a better future. And I think that personally at the moment, I feel very hopeful of a better future because of the younger generations coming up and the activism that they're showing and the kind of awareness that they have, which I'm not sure that all generations have. And so there is a lot of hope in us as we feel towards the future and a lot of hope that we see around. And I find it perfectly possible for the two to be compatible.
Yes, I think so. I mean, I think, as Yulia was saying, you know, melancholia is a sort of rational response to the world we find ourselves in. But at the same time, you know, there is this feeling of potential. There's this feeling of potential in the activist generation. And you know, that does make you hopeful.
It's often that we're not allowed the positive questions, are we? There's so many situations where we're bombarded with the negatives the whole time. And we're bombarded with the argumentation the whole time. And it's very easy to lose sight of the fact that you can move forward with positivity, even to something, you know, it is a very flawed document. It's a heavily critiqued document. but there are certainly things there to inspire a kind of future conversations and better ways forward and a more kinder world, really.
When I watched the video, what struck me more than anything else, and especially because I was listening to Max's music, it was the gaze of the children. And the way I read it was the determination in the eyes of the children. Is this something that you wanted to, a message that you wanted deliberately to convey?
Absolutely. It's all about the children for me. I mean, we ourselves have three children, of course, and so that's a conversation that I've been having for quite some time about what's the future we're handing to them and what is the future that they're seeing? What are they seeing in front of their eyes on the news every day in these 24-hour news cycles and this rapidly deteriorating society? So I think, it's central. Children are central.
Voices has been in the making for a number of years, but it was released in July 2020. Now, probably the moment of its release had been decided months before, though the release of the record happened days, perhaps weeks after the killing of George Floyd, when the Black Lives Matter movement was already, you know, protesting massively in the USA and all over the world to end racial discrimination in all its forms. All of a sudden, Voices became a symbol of this very particular historical moment. How did the situation affect both of you, and how did you experience it?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, a project like Voices, in a way, is always going to be seen through the lens of that present moment, you know, because there are always, you know, rights abuses going on everywhere. So in a sense, you know, it's natural for us to sort of connect it to that moment. But I mean, as far as what was happening, I guess it's last year now, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Obviously, that's a reckoning which has been, you know, centuries in the making, actually. You know, you have in America, a country which is basically designed along racist lines. And this kind of edifice, legal and social edifice, slowly being sort of unbuilt, dissolved, and hopefully a brighter world and a more just world emerging very slowly from its ashes. So obviously it affected us tremendously, as it affected everyone. I mean, I think it's been a huge, hopefully, turning point. Mm-hmm.
Did these sets of events gave to Voices a further layer in terms of its political meaning, its political value as a political statement?
Yeah, we were talking about this earlier, and we were talking about the word political in relation to this piece. And I mean, I don't really see it as political because for me, politics is about the, you know, the business of governments doing sort of government things. And actually, you know, the declaration is in a way more fundamental than that. It's about really basic, you know, the bedrock elements of how human beings should or can treat one another. And that to me isn't really political. It goes beyond politics. It's about something more fundamental than that.
Yeah. I really need to push you on this one, and this is a more technical question. In Voices, the orchestra and the artist are, so to say, upside down. You will correct my very non-technical, you know, terminology. Is this a decision related to the nature of your music? Is there another message? Is this a symbolic decision which is about the order of things?
Yes, well, I guess I wanted to embed the psychology and the philosophy of the piece into the musical atoms themselves. So the piece is about trying to find hope, in a way, in a dark time. And so the orchestra is composed almost all of you know, bass instruments. So it has this incredibly heavy texture. Yeah. But I was trying to make music which felt hopeful and which felt kind of luminous from that. So it's a technical challenge, but it's also a metaphor for our current time. You know, it's a very challenging time. It's a very anxiety-filled time. And we wanted to make a piece which felt hopeful. So it's like, you know, the alchemists, you know, transmuting base metal into gold, you know, out of this darkness, we try to make something brighter.
Absolutely. I relate to that because I'm about to talk about yet another video that I would like to share with our viewers. Voices went public for an avant-première at the Barbican in London days before the lockdown, the first lockdown. You could have certainly not imagined it then, but Voices, exactly as you mentioned them a second ago, Max, offered a message of hope during the pandemic that unfortunately is still with us today. So you basically confirmed my idea of Voices being a bridge from the world of yesterday into the world of tomorrow, the post-pandemic world. Would you agree with that?
Yeah.
I mean, especially if you look at the Mirrors video, it's doing the same thing in a visual form where I use the negatives of the flowers blooming. And again, it's the idea of out of the negative can come a positive. And it may not look like the world we had, but it can be good and it can be better. And I think that's central to us.
Absolutely. So let us watch and listen to an excerpt of the Barbican concert filmed by you, Yulia, and played by Max in February 2020. That was wonderful. Thank you very much. And in the third part of my presentation and my dialogue with you, I would like to ask both of you a few questions on the purpose and sense of community or communities. The first question that I had for you is, to what extent the current pandemic has changed your ways to think music, to think film, and to think life?
Well, I mean, I think it's both changed everything and changed nothing at the same time. I think it's made us more committed to doing what we're doing, and for the power of music and literature and film to allow people to speak to each other, basically. I think missing out on cultural events for a year has really impoverished our existence. I mean, obviously there are people fighting bigger battles currently, and it's not the most important battle. However, when it can come back, I think it provides a fantastic means of speaking to each other and kind of exploring issues and moving things on in spaces that are safe to do so, actually, and fun and fulfilling.
What are your projects about this moment, the day when the pandemic will be behind us?
Well, we've got a huge project going on. We're building and building, actually. We're doing a very different project now. It's not a musical piece. It's a place. We're building a kind of art farm that will have a lot of people come from, hopefully from all over the world, to creatively exchange through music, through film, through literature, through visual arts. And that's our next big project. It's a very different big project. Huge. It's been years in the making, but it's really been, this year really drove it. We've been working very hard to get it done in time, so that when things open up again, we can open up.
It seems to me that both of you, and for sure Max, as far as I can tell, you were particularly sensitive to this issue of building communities. If I go back to 2015 and your project Sleep, I read it also as a way of imagining communities. Would you like to say a few words on that project?
Yeah, I mean, Sleep is... In one aspect of Sleep is very much reimagining what music performance is, and how the musicians and the audience relate, and what that space looks like. And the performances are configured like a listening community, basically. So everyone comes along at 11 o'clock at night or something. They go to bed and we start to play for them.
All right.
And when we first played it, as musicians, of course, we were programmed in a way to perform. But just a few minutes in, and it was obvious that really what we weren't performing, what we were doing is we're accompanying this audience, these people, all lying down, all sleeping. And we're conveying them through the night. And there's something very different about that. And it was great.
One of the things under when I was living in Hungary, you had multi generations in one house living together in very small rooms. So I think I was with my great grandparents, my aunts, my mum. We were all in the tiny little flat, and sleeping in close proximity is a thing that you get very used to. And it's actually, you know, of course, it's also difficult, and especially for the adults, I guess. But for me as a child, it was a wonderland. And it's in terms of the talk that goes on, and if one person's playing music and drifting in and out of that sleepy space. So that's kind of that was part of the conversation of when Sleep came together, is
sure.
how you know, how do people, where are people sleeping? How are they relating to each other?
I would like to give our viewers a perfect example of your efforts to create a new community, and probably a signal of a message of hope. And this was your December 2020 concert on BBC Three, that which was then spread all over the world. And I would like all of us to listen to an excerpt of the chorale recorded in December 2020.
All human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. They are endowed with reason and conscience, and should act towards one another in a spirit of community. Everyone is entitled to all the rights and freedoms set forth in this declaration, without distinction of any kind, such as race, color, sex, language, religion, political or other opinion, national or social origin, property, birth, or other status. Furthermore, no distinction shall be made on the basis of the country to which a person belongs.
That was quite something. Thank you for sharing the video with us, Yulia and Max. I have a final question for both of you. Now, I learned that there is a new project going on, and the project is almost there. It's called Voices 2, and it will be out in April 2021, so a few days from now. I'm very curious to know more about this project and what was why it was urgent, important for both of you and for Max in particular to go back and recording more and give a sequel to Voices.
Yes, I mean Voices is I think of it really as a place to think about this text, about the words of the Declaration. It's a musical space for us to connect to that text. But then I felt like it would be nice to extend the musical space beyond the text itself, so that a little bit like a kind of visual after image or an echo, you have after the after Mercy plays, which is the end of Voices 1, you have actually this space to dream into, this space which is about things which haven't been said, stories which haven't been told, the potential future. So it's a kind of space to dream into the future.
I think one of the things that happened for us, you know, during this year is within 2 days of coronavirus shutting down borders, all projects for us were cancelled for 18 months. But actually that we're lucky because that gave us a very rich space to respond to the moment and what's going on at the moment. You rarely get that as an artist, such a kind of immediate ability to write or work at the time when something's happening. And I think Voices 2 has come out of that experience too, very much sitting with the moment completely at home all the time and just pouring all our thoughts into the second part of Voices.
I love the very creative way in which you showed all of us how we can be resilient, which I think is also part of how I interpret both of your answers. I would like to say goodbye to our viewers by sharing with them an excerpt of Mirrors, which in a way tells us something about Voices too, and goes back to the point that you made about the negative becoming positive, Yulia, earlier in our conversation. I would like to thank you very, very much for spending these few minutes with us in Geneva tonight, and I hope we can meet each other at some point. Thank you very much. Stay safe, and hope to see you very, very soon. Let's play this record. Thank you.
Thanks. Pleasure. Thank you.
Goodbye.